My name is Brian Lehrman, and I now know that I am a carrier for the CLN2 variant of Batten's disease. The reason I know this is because both my son and my daughter are affected by Batten's disease. I had a pretty normal, healthy upbringing and met my wife in college, and we were working and we decided to start a family. And we had a wonderful son named Chase, and he came out and he was what you would think of a normal child and toddler boy. He was active, loved to run around, loved to jump on things, and he was doing good. He just had a little bit of speech delay. And then one day we got a call from school when he was about 3 and a half, and they said that he had had a fall and it didn't look normal. So at first we said, oh, what do they really know? And we just watched him, but he had a couple more falls within a week. So we went to go see our pediatrician, and our pediatrician was very good, and he said, this sounds like it's probably neurological or epilepsy. We were living outside of Boston at the time, so he sent us right in to see the neurologist at Boston Children's Hospital. Well, within about 4 months, Chase's falls continued to increase. We later found out that they were drop fall seizures and he was having epileptic episodes. And they did an MRI on him. His brain structure looked like he had some decrease in area in his cerebellum. And so they did a battery of protein deficiency testing. And unfortunately, at that time, they came up with him being deficient in what's called the TPP1 enzyme, which helps your body and particularly your brain process fats. And so we went and we did some genetic testing. We determined that my wife and I are both carriers for Batten's disease, CLN2 chromosomal variation. And unfortunately, at this time, my wife was also 8 months pregnant with our second child, Courtney. So almost immediately after Courtney was born, we had her tested, and we found out that while it is a recessive inherited disorder, Courtney was also that 1 in 4 chance that she was affected as well. So at that time, we started to look for treatment options, and we looked at a variety of options. There was a gene therapy study that was in phase 1 trials at Cornell. There was some enzyme replacement therapy that might reach clinical trials soon at that point. But what we decided to go with is we decided to go with a bone marrow transplant at Duke with Dr. Kurtzberg's team. It was a medical team that we were familiar with because we had previously lived in the area. And Dr. Kurtzberg, while she had never treated a patient with Batten's before, was able to show us some brain imagery with Hurler's disease and adrenal leukodystrophies that show that for some of these neurological degenerative disorders that are similar to Batten's, they were successfully treated with stem cell bone marrow transplants. So we did our transplants in May of 2013. Both Chase, who was roughly 4 at the time, and Courtney, who was 4 months, transplanted on the same day. My wife stayed with one of them, and I stayed with Chase. And the process was long and involved for anyone that's ever been through a bone marrow transplant. You have several days of isolation. The kids don't feel good. It's hard to take a toddler through, and there are complications. So unfortunately, through this evolving process, our son Chase passed away just before he turned 5. Approximately 1 year after transplant. And that's been very sad and hard for our family to deal with. But I would still do that transplant again because the normal life expectancy with a child with CLN2 Batten's is 8 to 12 years, and it's not a very good life. So we took the avenue that we thought had the best chance to give Chase the closest to a normal life, and unfortunately it just didn't work. However, the story with Courtney has been different. She had a very good transplant experience. She engrafted well. Her complications have been relatively minor. So here we are today, roughly 2.5 years post-transplant, and she is doing very well. She's a 3-year-old now. She runs around, she has good motion. She does have a little bit of speech delay, which we continue to work with. We continue to go in to work with therapists. We go to clinic for follow-up for the transplant once a month. And the next year I'll be telling, but we have a lot of hope left now that Courtney will be able to recover and leave a more normal life from something that, when we got the diagnosis, we were told that our only options were really palliative care and that to make them comfortable until they passed. So things like the rare disease networks are very important to us. One of the biggest frustrations we had through all of this was the fact that Batten's disease is a disease that can be tested for but is not part of newborn screening panels. And the reason that it's not part of newborn screening panels is because the criteria today for newborn screening says that an effective treatment must exist. So we have really two goals. One is to show that effective treatments do exist, and two would be to change that criteria, because even if there isn't a medical intervention that is possible at the time, it's very useful to know early that your child is affected. So we would encourage newborn screening with expanded panels. We also encourage parental screening. There are screenings that exist now for prospective parents that'll tell you about these inherited diseases. And all I can say is, having lived through the upheaval and the impacts to the family from having children with an inherited disease, I would want to know early on if that was a possibility. And then through assistive reproductive therapies, there are ways to still have healthy kids that will allow you to avoid the disease. So, you know, I would encourage early diagnosis, early screening, and to work with panels to really help for awareness and just to help the kids, because no kid deserves to have a life-limiting disease early on, when there are things that you can do to identify it and there are things that you can do to ease their care and work with them in specialized situations to help make their life as fulfilling as possible. So for other parents that are going through this, I would just say, first of all, be patient with your kids, show them all the love they can show them, and be proactive in going out to the community. There are great communities that exist for parents with rare diseases. Batten's Disease Society for Research, BDSRA, is a great umbrella organization that we've used to read their Facebook pages. So be proactive in terms of finding out what you can do for your kid when you get one of these diagnoses, and then challenge the doctors. Some doctors will tell you that there is nothing you can do, and for my wife and I and our extended family, that was not an acceptable answer. We've taken active intervention. Unfortunately, our son passed, but we think it's given our daughter a real chance by making that intervention. So I would say, when you're a parent and you're confronted with this, people have different coping mechanisms. It's very tempting to sort of ball up within yourself, but it's more productive to spread your wings and do some outreach and try to learn all you can and do all you can for your child, and show them all the love you can in the world.